is episode 104 of Hebrews in Exile with our honorable teacher, Robert B. Holman Jr. and Sean Appleton. And we are going to finish our review of a video Alan Parr and Mike Winger have put out about Hebrew Israelites. We're going to give you our final comments and review and clarifications that really dispel some of the things that they have published about Hebrew Israelites. So without any further ado, Hebrews in Exile, let's go!
Of the harvest, you're of my light, you're of creation, you make everything right.
This is Rabbi Robert B. Holman Jr. and
Sean Appleton,
and this is
Hebrews in Exile.
Every week we come to do the podcast, and there's are things that transpire and that happen.
Mm-hmm.
Within the context of my week.
Okay.
And
story time.
One of the things that I hear King David say, King David say, he says, I meditate upon your mitzvot day and night.
Day and night.
Well, interestingly enough, my task is different than yours.
Okay, how so?
Well, in that, my task is to consistently keep before Hebrew Israel the importance of the mitzvot, which you do also.
Yeah,
but I have to be more direct with them. And more repetitious.
Mm.
And with that, I'm thinking, you know, I'm thinking all the time. And I go to bed at night. And when I go to bed at night, I pray and I ask the Most High to let my dreams and my thoughts through the night resonate within the context of His Word. And it works.
Man, you know what? You just gave me a nugget. That's a gold nugget right there.
Because I'm dreaming.
Uh-huh.
And I'm teaching or I'm talking about or I'm doing something with mitzvot.
Do you find that when those mitzvot come up, those dreams are very vivid?
Huh?
Those dreams that you're having, those visions that you have, yeah, are very vivid.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And I'm looking at me doing or talking about mitzvot to somebody, something. I don't know. It's just mitzvot.
Right. Right. I mean, our lives exemplify that. I mean, we're walking mitzvot.
Yeah.
We should be, at least.
Well, for two podcasts now, we have been dealing with this Alan Parr and
Mike Winger.
Mm-hmm. Issue of what's up with the black Hebrew Israelites. And we've been dealing with that, and we're going to close it out in this session. It's taken us three sessions to climb through this quagmire of mess that these two gentlemen have put out for public consumption.
Hmm.
So let me say it up front now. I've really had enough of them, but we got to finish it up.
Sure. Sure.
But I would not ever put myself out to be or to speak in an authoritative way about something that I don't have a clue about or if it's based on one sampling.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Well, okay. Okay, go ahead.
And that's what this is. Secondly, balls, as we get into it tonight, Mr. Parr and Mr.
Winger. Yes.
Do not understand that their conversation is about one of their own.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's... They call themselves fundamental Christians.
Mm-hmm.
And whereas the Hebrews that also follow the Greek narrative and believe in Yeshua
mm-hmm.
as being God manifested in the flesh
mm-hmm.
are the same thing that fundamental Christians are.
Yeah.
I mean, they're simply, they call them Hebrew Christians.
Hebristians, yeah. Yeah. That we're...
And you know, and I got to say this again.
Sure.
I don't, what's the word I'm looking for? I'm not being disparaging about them
mm-hmm.
because from 2007 till 2018 or so, or 17 or 18, we were the same.
Exactly. Exactly. Now, I think it's very important that people understand that, just like you're saying, you need to hear, like Paul Harvey, and I think we mentioned this in another podcast, you need to hear the other side of the story.
Yeah, now here's what the story is. Now, here's the rest of the story.
Here's the rest of it. You need something fair and balanced. This is kind of like the Fox News of Hebrewism here, and you know, you're getting a narrative, and you're not really hearing the whole thing in its totality. So, yeah, just to provide clarity, I think I can speak for both of us, we invite either one of these gentlemen to have
a conversation
so we can reason together about a lot of stuff. But it's a lot of stuff that, you know, thus far that we're hearing is very hypocritical. Calling us certain things, and even within the, I'm going to use their vernacular, their parlance, the Christian camps with there are a plethora of them.
Of them.
Right.
Are worse than.
Right.
Are worse than.
So it seems a little disingenuous to be throwing stones when you're prescribing to something that, you know, and I've said it before, and I'm going to say it one more time, at least to Hebrews. That's that same group that showed up back in the day that was burning crosses on your front porch, on your front yard, in the name of the person that you pray into. Okay? So as far as, you know, violence and whatnot and seeking, I don't know, no Hebrews that are out there going to do any of that stuff.
No, they're not
going to
do none of that.
It actually forbids us to go to do anything unless the Most High directs us to, number one. Number two, the Most High has this thing where he does the fighting for us.
Yes.
And what you've seen from Hebrews is nothing but community and camaraderie. When Brother Irving was going through his political barrage, it was the Hebrew Hebristians that showed up, that Hebrew camp that showed up that he's talking about.
Yeah,
they showed up in unity with each other.
To support his position.
That's right.
And a lot of the also, mm-hmm. you know, is in support of the fact that, if we use this, I don't know, is this new term woke, does it apply?
I don't even know. I don't even like using that. But
our people are wakening up to realize that they are a part of the Hebrew nation of Israel.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Knowledge evolves.
Mm-hmm.
And if you and I are seeking truth, then knowledge will evolve and help you to understand, as the book of Malachi writes, the difference between mm-hmm. that which is set apart and that which is not set apart.
Agreed.
And which belongs to, in text, to a correct understanding. Well, let's get into this before we run out of time.
Let's do it.
Let's run it from this point. We're going to start tonight with this part of the podcast, which talks about what are some of their beliefs, meaning the Black Hebrews. And Mr. Parr is going to talk about, because of this, some extremist groups believe that Jews are usurping their right of being God's chosen people and therefore are anti-Semitic. So that's where we're going to start right there tonight.
Okay, so it's going to come on the tail end of, we'll just let it play for a little bit, and then he'll go right into this next piece. All right.
Now, I don't know how they interpret the last part. But the point is this, guys, I want you to see that this is how they take verses out of context, and this is how cults get started, okay? Now, we got a lot to cover here, so let me just keep going here.
I got to stop this again, because every time he talks about taking something out of context, man.
Yeah, you talk about taking stuff out of context. Man.
The Greek text, from a pure Hebrew perspective, and people who study not only the first five books, which is the embodiment of which the Torah resides, but the prophets and the writings.
Absolutely.
For people who study the prophets and the writings and try to look at what's over in the Greek text, that Greek New Testament, everything in it that is in parentheses or bold that refers back to our Hebrew text, all of that there is out of context.
Absolutely.
Every last word, every last reference in it is out of context. He doesn't know that because he's not a Hebrew. He doesn't know that because he's a fundamental Christian. He doesn't know that because they don't teach what we're talking about in any seminary. None.
What are some of their other beliefs? Well, because of this, there's some extremist groups that believe that Jews, and they're not the real children of Israel. No. We are Hebrew Israelites. We are the true tribes of Israel. But they believe that the Jews are just usurping their right to be God's chosen people. And therefore, they are anti-Semitic. Now, I need to explain this because I don't want to get in too much trouble with the Hebrew Israelites.
You're not already in trouble with me.
Every Hebrew Israelite is an anti-Semitic. I'm talking about some of the extremist groups. The extremist groups, there's some extremist groups that are anti-Semitic, and so you have to understand that. Why? Because they believe that Jews are stealing their identity, right? So that's the idea.
That has nothing to do with being extremist.
Now, let's talk about this for a minute, and let's talk about it. We're going to talk about it within the framework of text, and we're going to talk about it in the framework of history. Extremist groups believe that Jews are usurping their right to being El's chosen people and are therefore anti-Semitic. Mr. Parr doesn't know scripture or his history of the Jewish, particularly the Ashkenazis, nor does he know the history of melanated people in scripture. He doesn't know either one. So, let me deal with one part first. Let's go to Bereshit chapter 10, which is Genesis chapter 10 and verse number 2. It says, the sons of Japheth are Gomer, Magog, Madai, Yovan, Tuvol, Meshach, Tyrus. The sons of Gomer are Ashkenaz,
yes.
Riphat, Togomar.
Yep.
The text says that they are from Japheth along with many of the European nations. The European nations are the conglomerate that make up Gog and Magog. Okay. If Mr. Parr does not know his European history, he should study it and find out who people are and how prophetic scripture is into the present age and time. The Ashkenazis, white Jews, are people who are of Khazar ancestry in the 8th century. They adopted Judaism. Now, there are several books, two books by Elmer von Frasher, one named The Black Hebrews and the Black Christ. The other is named The Black Role in the Bible. There's another book by Mawali called The Call, The Hebrews. And there's another by Janice Winston, Go Tell My People Who They Are. Then there are the well-documented books up by the Nation of Islam, The Secret Relation Between Blacks and Jews, How Jews Gained Control of the Black American Economy, another by them called Auction Sales, Jews Selling Blacks, with pictures of slave sale advertising by American Jews. Hmm. All these books are very well done and document the Ashkenazi's activities with the true people of the Most High, the nation of Black Hebrew Israel. Before anybody calls anybody anti-Semitic or berates them, they should read these books and gain some knowledge. In Almar Van Flasher's writings, he points out that the blackness within the Bible and how the Ashkenazis became Jews. So, know your facts before you speak about as an authoritarian on Hebrew Israel and its melanation. Mm-hmm. Now let's go to
the prophet.
Let's go to text.
Okay.
Let's go to Yeshayahu, which is Isaiah chapter number 44.
Yep.
And we'll start with verse number 1, but we're going to skip down.
Okay.
No, maybe we'll just read it all.
Oh, really? We're going to go 44:1.
We go to 44:1-5.
Okay. Let's get it.
You want to read?
Sure. 44, Yeshayahu, verse 1. Now listen, Yaakov, my servant, Yisrael, who I have chosen. Thus says Yahweh, who made you, formed you in the womb, and will help you. Don't be afraid, Yaakov, my servant, Yisroel, whom I have chosen, for I will pour water on the thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. I will pour my spirit on your descendants, my blessings on your offspring. Verse 4, they will spring up among the grass like willows on the riverbanks. One will say, I belong to Yahweh. Another will be called by the name of Yaakov. Yet another will write that he belongs to Yahweh and adopt the surname Yisrael.
Now, this is where this right here in verse 5, first of all, there's a lot of language between verse 1 and verse 5 that are metaphoric and have a far different meaning than what we're reading here in text. But the one that stands out is verse number 5. One mm-hmm. will say, I belong to Yahweh. Another will be called by the name of Yaakov. Yet another will write that he belongs to Yahweh and adopt the surname of Israel.
Israel.
So you have the Ashkenazis who are descendants of Yefat. So if they are descendants of Yefat, I cannot be anti-Semitic when I refer to them in relationship to their heritage.
Correct.
Number two, in, golly, I think I always forget it, and I just used it the other day, and I forget the text. Go tell Avraham the Hebrew.
Oh, yeah. That's so in Bereshit.
When we look at Hebrew Israel, we know that Avraham is a person of color.
Mm-hmm.
From Avraham comes Jacob and Esau. Esau comes out red and hairy, but he's still part of the family. Then we have the sons of Yaakov, which are the 12 sons that make up the whole nation of Israel. So let's go back. If we go back and we understand text and history right, if Father Abraham is a melanated man and his son Isaac Isaac is a melanated man, mm-hmm. and Jacob is a melanated man, then the 12 sons of Israel are melanated people, and they're not white.
No, they're not. Not at all.
So when I rise up and I recognize the connection textually that I have with my ancestors, yes, I am a descendant of Hebrew Israel, because Hebrew Israel has been dispersed into the four corners of the world.
That's right.
And we're going to go back to something that Mr. Parr said earlier that says, well, Hebrew Israel want to connect with Devarim chapter 28 verses 15 through 68. I can't say what I really want to say, but yeah, doggone right. Because right. I want Mr. Parr to tell me, find me a nation or a group of people that fits the narrative in Yeshua and Devarim 28:15 through 68. Find me a people that fit that. It certainly is not the Ashkenazis.
It sure isn't. No, they don't fit that narrative.
The Ashkenazis own the entertainment business. Mm-hmm. They own a majority of the financial institutes. They are not hated like the melanated man in the world at all. They are not treated. Yes, they've had some hard times, mm-hmm. but they've had some hard times because of the things that they did.
Of course, yeah.
And we have to go back to text again, and we got to look at text. Text defines that the Most High has used nations that are not Israel to whoop Israel's behind to try to get her to repent and turn back to him.
That's right. That's right.
And he has spelled it out in text. He has spelled it out in Isaiah. You start reading Yeshayahu chapter 13 down through about 24 thereabouts. He talks about all the nations that he's used to bring Israel back to him. He's talked about the exile nations. Mm-hmm. He does the same thing in the book of Ezekiel. So my point being here is to say to him, yeah, you're doggone right. The Ashkenazi Jews are not Semitic people, and I'm not being anti-Semitic to say that. I'm going strictly by text.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're going to call me anti-Semitic, then you're going to have to call the text or the word that the Most High has given to Moshe to explain these nations of people in Bereshit chapter 10. You're going to have to call them anti-Semitic, which just means you're going to be calling the Most High anti-Semitic.
Yeah.
You better watch your mouth.
Right, because then you're treading on that you better watch
your mouth.
Yeah.
Consequently, we need to understand, what does the text say? And I'm not talking about a Greek text. I'm not talking about a text that's written by Eurocentric. I'm talking about the Masoretic text, and I'm talking about the scroll that the Ashkenazis use.
Mm-hmm.
So if we're going to question the issue of their origin, let's turn to your scroll.
Right.
Which you have been preserving for us up until this time.
That's right.
It's our scroll.
Mm-hmm.
We're Hebrew. We can read Hebrew. We can write Hebrew.
We can speak
it. It's our language.
Yep. That's right.
So if your ethnicity is something, that's what your language is.
Mm-hmm.
But the Ashkenazi's language is not Hebrew. Actually, it's Yiddish.
That's correct. That's correct. And that's where you kind of, like when the Sephardics, they have their own particular language and dialect that they use too. It comes out of, I believe, in the Spain region. I've been trying to find that portion of text that you talk about where Avraham, the Hebrew.
Oh, it might be.
And I'm down in 14.
It might be in chapter 19. I can't remember where it is. And I use it all the time, so I should remember it, but I don't. That's okay.
Yeah.
That's okay. It's in the book of Bereshit when
Lot gets taken.
Yeah, when Lot gets taken and he's off to war. But yep. Let's go on.
Okay, let's do it.
So his point about white people, once again, is not part of the purest Hebrews narrative. The purists believe that all people, according to Torah mitzvot, has the right at salvation and being part of Hebrew Israel. And I think if we've gotten there, I think he's going to bring that up next. I think I've got ahead of myself. But let's play him on here.
Okay.
Now, some extremist groups believe that white people, sorry all my white brothers and sisters, but they believe that white people are deceiving people like me, a people of color, with a whitewashed version of Christianity. And therefore, white people cannot be descendants of Israel. Excuse me, white people cannot be descendants of Israel and therefore are evil and cannot be saved.
Mm-mm. That's not what purists believe.
No.
That's not what purists believe. Yeah. As far as ethnicity and descendants of Hebrew Israel is a pure, melanated nation
of people.
People.
Yep.
To which, Bamidbar number 15 calls everybody that isn't ethnically connected to Hebrew Israel,
mm-hmm.
he calls them foreigners.
That's correct.
And there's a mitzvot that we have
mm-hmm.
that addresses and speaks to us to remember how to treat the foreigner.
That's right.
Because remember, you were
a foreigner in Egypt.
You were a servant or a slave in Mitzrayim. So mm-hmm. you were a foreigner there. So you need to remember how to treat the foreigner.
Yes.
Now, he also gives us the Numbers, chapter 15 and 15. He tells us that there shall be one Torah for you, Israel,
mm-hmm.
and for the foreigner who resides with you.
Right.
So now what the foreigner has to join with Hebrew Israel,
mm-hmm.
accept Hebrew Israel's Elohim and the Torah that the Most High has given to us.
Mm-hmm.
When that happens, you become one with Israel, such as is the narrative with Ruth and Naomi.
That's true. And not only that, you have that narrative throughout the whole entire fiber.
Yeah.
I'm going to give an analogy real quick, if I can, because I know we got to get through this. It's just like having a marriage with, you marry someone, and that particular person that you marry, that you're marrying into that family. That family has a bloodline. You're not necessarily blood, but once you marry into that family, you're treated just like your family. So it's the same deal. There is a bloodline through the Empire of Israel that is through the loins of Yaakov, Israel. And that bloodline, you are able to join in with that bloodline and have, and matter of fact, you become subject to all the mitzvot just like Hebrew Israel is. I mean, well, just like the descendants of Yaakov are. You are, there's no ifs, ands, or buts about it.
Right.
You fall subject to it. And there's some specific mitzvot for the foreigner that are in there as well. But again, this comes along with having, being well-versed and knowing what the mitzvot actually
now,
are.
Now let's be clear. Let's not put this word evil solely on white people.
Yeah, that's
not. Every ethnicity on the planet of this earth have some people in it that are wicked and evil.
Yeah.
And are not ever going to see the light of salvation.
Sure. Agreed.
Okay.
Agreed.
So we purists don't have that thought process.
Correct.
We don't think evil about people who are not like us.
Right.
We think about people in the same context as the Most High thinks about people, in that he has made man in his image and in his likeness.
Mm-hmm.
And out of that man that he made, which was a melanated man, mm-hmm. all other ethnic groups come out of that one man.
It's correct. Correct.
So I mean,
the Most High is so beautiful because he's consistent with everything that he does. Hebrew Israel is a leader to the nations. You can join with her or you can decide not to join with her. There is a leader in the home. The man is the leader of the home. There is a leader of the country. There is the leader of Hebrew Israel, which is the Most High. Every group has a leader.
Yes.
So it is it is not rational to think that, oh, okay, well, there isn't somebody that's supposed to be the catalyst that represents the Most High. Yes, there will be. And you're afforded those same opportunities. But I digress.
And all people have the right of salvation and being a part of Hebrew Israel.
Correct.
Right? And so, once again, guys, this is not every Hebrew Israelite that you will meet, but some of the extremists, which is why I put it in red bold, some of the extreme groups that you may see on YouTube and things of that nature, they subscribe to this idea that white people are evil, they enslave black people, and then their punishment for enslaving African people is that they are going to be punished in the afterlife, and they cannot be saved because of what they've done.
Okay, so let me deal with that one just real quick. We have been enslaved by all races of folks. Okay, it's not just the transatlantic slave trade that is just systemic to Europeans. Before the transatlantic slave trade happened, 700 years before that, you can see an evidence in history that there was an Indian Ocean slave trade that dispersed people out of Africa into the wherever they took them. So it's not just white people that just did this. It's not systemic to one group of people that is going to oppress Hebrew Israel. The Most High will use whomever he pleases in order to get you back in line.
Right.
So just making it about white people is solely incorrect. So our Hebrew brothers, Hebristians that are out there that are preaching that narrative upon which you're pooling your information from, it's very flawed.
Done to African people, all right? So that is just a few things. And now, what do they believe about Jesus? They primarily believe that Jesus was a created being. They believe that Jesus essentially was a man who came and fulfilled the Old Testament law perfectly. Therefore, he acts as proof that it's possible for us to obey the Old Testament law perfectly. So the idea is they see Jesus as a created being, a man who was able to fulfill the Old Testament law perfectly. And therefore, if Jesus can fulfill the Old Testament law perfectly, then he serves as a model that it's possible for you and I to fulfill the Old Testament law perfectly. So that's why he came, to fulfill the law and to show us how it's done. All right?
Oh, well, wow. That's
purists. Hebrew purists, what do we believe about Jesus or Yeshua? Well, first of all, we believe that according to text, that the opulent spirit, the absolute all-existent one, who's called El, cannot be or ever become flesh.
Correct.
What do we base it on? We base it on Bamidbar, Numbers chapter 23 and verse 19. And it says, El is not a human who lies, nor a mortal who changes his mind. When he says something, he will do it. And when he makes a promise, he will fulfill it. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
That's one. Two, in Yeshayahu, chapter number 44, verse 6, thus says Yahweh, Israel's King and Redeemer, Yahweh Sabaoth, or Yahweh of Hosts. I am the first, I am the last, and beside me there is no God. Who is like me? Let him speak out. Let him show me clearly what has been happening since I set up the eternal people. Ooh, who's the eternal people?
Uh-oh. I wonder who they
since
are.
Since I set up the eternal people, now we got to come back and ask a question. Mm-hmm. Is there any narrative in the Greek text where Jesus Christ proclaims anything about the eternal people. Let him foretell future signs and events. Let me go back and read this again.
Okay.
Beside me there is no El. Who is like me? Let him speak out. Let him show me clearly what has been happening since I, the first and the last, set up the eternal people. Let him foretell future signs and events. This is just one of the many of the Hebrew text that expresses this point by the Most High El, besides his word that he is a jealous El and will not give his glory to another. So if he's not going to give his glory to another, why and for what purpose does he need a surrogate to represent him?
Correct. In the Eretz. I got to talk on. You finish your point? I got to talk about this other issue right here that Mr. Parr brings up, and I just want to bring clarification to it. Let's be clear. For the purist, for the Hebraic purist.
We're not extremists. Let's get that out of your head. We are not extremists.
Yes, exactly. If you study the mitzvot and you understand the mitzvot, Yeshua didn't come and fulfill them. That's abundantly clear. I draw your attention to one of the most egregious ones, which is out there. Why would the Most High El, the El that you serve, the El that created the heavens and the earth, that delivered these people called Hebrews from the hand of bondage and gave them a land and gave them a constitution? And in that constitution, he says, what? You are not to drink blood. You are not to eat flesh. Why in the world would the Most High come down in flesh and tell you to and violate his own word and say, this is the representation of blood and my body? We're teaching people to be cannibals and drink blood. How is that fulfilling the mitzvot?
You know, even if it's metaphorically, it's wrong.
It's still wrong. I mean, even you got these issues of, what about the woman with the issue of blood that touched Yeshua in the crowd? As soon as she touched him, she would have been unclean.
Yes.
Per the mitzvot. Okay, what about another one? What about the fact that, Yeshua's over here. We got to get through this. But there's too many examples that are in there that show that he didn't come and fulfill the law. If he came to fulfill the law, then or fulfill the mitzvah or the commandment, then where is his Torah scroll? And I'm not talking about writing Bereshit all the way to the end of Deuteronomy or Devarim. I'm talking about where is his Torah scroll? Where in the world did you write down any of the mitzvahs if you are the king?
Because there's a mitzvah that said every king must write
His own
Torah. And we're not talking about the first five books. We're talking about the rules and the regulations that the Most High has given to Hebrew Israel that every king is supposed to write.
Right. So that's actually addressing two fronts. One, where the Hebristians are saying they're still believing in Yeshua. I would challenge my Hebristian brothers who really lean more toward being Hebraic than Christian to really evaluate and do a checklist to see whether or not this man actually even measures up to fulfilling the mitzvot, which you will see over time that he doesn't.
He doesn't.
Okay. And then it deals with this issue that Mr. Parr just brought up about the fact that, we got a whole bunch of people saying that.
But you see,
he fulfilled them.
But you see, Christians can't do that because they don't know Hebraic study.
That's correct.
Because they have taken it and set it aside as old, antiquated, and it's been done away with, and he's fulfilled it. So we're not spending any time over here. But if you're not spending any time over here, then why do you subscribe to the narrative where we've got our Masoretic text, Hebraic text, pasted into your document to make a point? What is this called? Bait and switch?
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we can't stay on that too long. We'll be here for a while.
Mr. Parr says he can talk about this stuff all day. Well,
so can we.
But we are going to tell people the truth and connect them to the scripture and not misinformation.
Right? Now, how do you approach a Hebrew Israelite? And then I'll move on, because I can talk about this stuff all day. How do you approach a Hebrew Israelite? Several things I want to talk to you about. Number one, you need to be skilled in the art of debate and apologetics. If you are going to have a discussion with a Hebrew Israelite, if you are not skilled in the area of debate and apologetics, you need to be very clear. You need to be very careful, and you may want to steer clear, because you may leave that conversation feeling more discouraged about your faith, because they know what they believe and why they believe it, which is very consistent with any cult group. And so if you're not strong...
Whoa. I appreciate... I appreciate the accolade.
Absolutely.
And what you're telling me is that Christians don't know what they believe.
That's exactly what he said.
If you ask the average Christian what he believes and to explain it, he can't do it.
Won't have, yeah.
If you ask the average Christian, what are you redeemed from? And what's redemption to you?
Mm-hmm.
They're going to tell you something that's all outside the purview of text, because mm-hmm. they don't know.
And we have the license to speak like this because we've come out of it. It's not like we haven't been there before.
Exactly.
So we're not from this, where they're coming from.
No.
They haven't been Hebrew, talking about Hebrews. We've been Christian.
We've been Christian.
Right. So we have license.
And now we're Hebrew.
Exactly.
We're kind of like Shaul. Shaul could speak because he'd been on both sides of the subject.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah.
To be able to defend what you believe, you may leave that conversation questioning everything that you've ever believed.
That's the point.
Another thing I'll say is this: have a firm grasp.
And that's the point for us. We are supposed to understand.
Yeah.
And give. And I'm going to go to your text that says, "And give every man a reasonable answer for the hope that lies within you." We can do that.
Yes.
We purists can do that.
Mm-hmm.
We can explain to you from A to Z the Most High.
Mm-hmm.
And what his expectations are for Hebrew Israel, mm-hmm. and the created man. Because it's not just for Hebrew Israel, it's for the created man. Oh, we can do that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one needs to be skilled in debate. Let me share something with you. There's one thing that I can't speak for any other purist, but I can speak for me.
Mm.
There's one thing that I will never do. I will never sit across a table and debate what the Most High has said.
Mm.
Now, you may think that this is a debate. This is not a debate. This is clarifying error.
Mm.
We're not debating this. And if Mr. Parr and Mr. Wiener were here, I wouldn't debate with them. I would simply go and let's talk about what text says.
Sure.
And let's talk about what history says.
Sure.
But when it comes to the word of the Most High,
mm-hmm.
I'll never sit across the table and debate anything the Most High has said.
Sure.
There is no pro and con in what the Most High has said. What he has said, he has said. Mm-hmm. What he will do, he will do. And I, in the flesh, and my little black skin, don't have any authority or ability to debate what the Most High has said.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So what we're doing is not a debate. It's just correcting information. The majority of what Mr. Parr has espoused in this podcast is error, or not error, but applies to his own religious sect of people, Hebrew Christians.
Mm.
And I thank you for the compliment that
now we're
we
well
do
studied,
know
yeah.
why we believe what we believe.
Asked on the relationship a believer has with the law and salvation, because they're going to press you on this idea of the law, the Old Testament law. The law was not done away with. You need to obey the law. Jesus fulfilled the law. And so you need to obey the law. If you don't understand the relationship between a believer and the Old Testament law, you can easily be deceived. Third thing I'll say is have a firm grasp on the Hebrew language. When you get into communication with a Hebrew Israelite, you might see that they are going to use some Hebrew words. And if you're like, I don't know any Hebrew, they're going to convince you that you don't know what you're talking about. Because if you don't know Hebrew and they claim to know Hebrew, they're going to use that as kind of their ace in the hole card to prove that what you believe is wrong. Another thing I'll say is you need to understand how the Bible was formed, right? Because many of them, like I said earlier, will throw out different parts of the Bible and they'll say, okay, I believe this and not that. So it's helpful to understand those things as well. And then the other thing that I'll say is,
Mr. Parr, do you know how the Bibles were formed? Do you know the origin of time frame in which that the majority of Bibles came into existence? Do you know who authored them? Do you know how far back and when they begin coming forward, in which that we have a number of them in play?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know that? Because we know how the Bible was formed.
Mm. We know.
I know from the time that the Septuagint was formulated down to when the International, I forget what it is, and I got it here, but I didn't bring it up. Every Bible in play, every last one,
yeah,
except the Masoretic text, every one of them is authored, composed.
Mm-hmm.
And has the fingerprint of European people.
Mm-hmm.
History records that there are more commentaries, there were more commentaries than there were Bibles back in the medieval times.
Mm.
Who are these medieval people that history's talking about? They're not melanated people.
Mm.
The Eurocentrics,
mm-hmm.
from which you, Mr. Parr, and you, Mr. Wiener, if you went to seminary and you studied, well, you studied from the commentaries of these medieval commentaries that have been passed down to your fathers and your father's father,
sure.
and your father's father, to where we get Jameson and Clark, Matthew Henry, and all of these other commentaries that are trying their best to describe Hebrew texts, but can't because your fathers don't know and were not Hebrew.
Mm.
So you see, you need to come talk to me. Call us. Email me, ftf@firsttab.org. Email me.
But he's gonna have to. That's gonna be a while.
You know, email me.
He's gonna have to go through all his points that he had before. I gotta be well versed. I gotta be ready, studied up before I come talk to him.
Now, I'm gonna let you listen to the last of this, but I'm gonna close this out. The law has not been done away with.
Sure.
Let's listen to your writer in Acts. And also in Romans.
Oh, yeah.
Shaul states that the law is spirit,
mm-hmm.
in Romans 7:14. Can an all-existent spirit be done away with? And how can you do away with something that the Most High El said would be throughout all your generations, as he does in Numbers 15:15? Has Hebrew Israel ceased to exist?
Mm.
How can you say something's been done away with when in Acts 24 and 14, Shaul in your text says, I am of the way, which is called a sect. I believe in the Torah or the law and the prophets. Now, if this is not true, and if Shaul's speaking out of both sides of his head, which he's not, because he's influenced, everything that Shaul has written, his letters, are all influenced by Eurocentrics who did not like Torah. That's historically written.
That's right.
There's a guy named Eusebius, who was Constantine's authority on the New Testament. He did not like Torah, and he changed a lot of the things that Shaul wrote. Me take you to a point in 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians, I think it is chapter 7, where Shaul is talking about circumcision. And he goes on and says, whether a person is circumcised or whether he's not circumcised is not the point. You should come and receive whatever he's talking about as you would. But then the next line goes on, however, you should pay attention to the covenant. Let me get it. I got time. Let me get it.
Yeah, because
I want to get that one straight.
I'm just asking you to save me a little piece. Little piece after end. Once you finish. Because yeah, I got one, too.
It's in seven.
Okay.
It's in seven. Seven. Come on. Talk for me while I look at
this. Okay, because I can't because I got my star witness getting ready to come to the stand here. I'm trying to prep him in the back real quick because he's going to take the center stage when we're dealing with this issue of the law being done away with.
Oh, here it is. Verse 17. 1 Corinthians 7:17. Only let each person live the life that the Lord has assigned to him and live it in the condition he was when El called him. This is the rule I lay down in all congregations. So this is not the Most High. This is not the Spirit of the Most High. This is Shaul. Supposedly talking. Was someone already circumcised when he was called? Then he should not try to remove the marks of circumcision. Was someone uncircumcised when he was called? He shouldn't undergo Brit Milah. Being circumcised means nothing. Being uncircumcised means nothing. What does mean something is keeping Yahweh's God's commandment.
But that it's one of them is but being circumcised.
Being circumcised is one of his commandments. So now I'm not confused, but you talk about misleading text here. Yeah. This is misleading text.
Right. Taking it out of context.
This is taking text out of context.
Totally.
You go.
Well, I'd like to...
Because I'm through.
Your Honor, I'd like to bring my star witness to the stand, and I'd like Yeshua HaMashiach to come to the stand, please. And I'm actually going to use from your, Mr. HaMashiach, your statement that you made here to your own people, upon which Mr. Parr and Mr. Winger believe. I take you no further than Matthew 5, verses 17, where it says, don't think that I've come to abolish the Torah. That's the mitzvot, y'all. Or the prophets. Don't think that I've come to abolish them, to do away with them. I have not come to abolish, but to complete. Yes, indeed, I tell you that until heaven and earth pass away, which they haven't, not so much as a yod or a stroke will pass from the Torah.
And you don't know what a yod and a stroke is because you don't know Hebrew.
That's right. Not until everything that must happen has happened. 19. So whoever whoever disobeys the least of these mitzvot and teaches others to do so will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever obeys them and so teaches will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. 20. For I tell you that unless your righteousness is far greater than the Torah teachers and the Parashim, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. That's coming out of the mouth of your own teacher. Lest I go on in verse 21, he's talking about, he starts quoting the mitzvot, don't murder. When you get down to 27, he quotes, don't commit adultery. If you go down even further to 31, he talks about if anybody divorces someone, that they should give him a get. He understands what these mitzvot are. Your teacher, your master, the one you pray to and bow down and cry over, this man that you idolize, who's become your God, is quoting the Hebraic mitzvot. 31, whoever divorces and must give his wife a get, that's a mitzvah. If you break your oath in 33, he's quoting mitzvahs left and right. He's not doing away with anything. So I don't understand how talk about cults and twisting things. This now becomes, it's been done away with and we don't have to do them.
Well,
I rest.
You rest. Well, I tell you, that the Most High is very, very, very clear and is not ambiguous in any way in terms of anything that he has ever put before his people.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing to debate about him. Your Greek text is skewed. It's ambiguous. It's misleading. And it's a half-truth, and a half-truth is
a whole lie.
A whole lie.
Mm-hmm.
And I can prove that to you. I can. As a matter of fact, this whole clarification that we've gone through mm-hmm. in these three podcasts established the clarity of the historical understanding of Hebrew Israel and text.
Yes.
We're purists. We're not extremists. We're not a cult. And as I close this podcast this evening, be careful what you say about Hebrew Israel and their El, lest that the words that you say become blasphemous, even if it's an error, because you are speaking as an authority. Therefore, you ought to know your words that come out of your mouth and know that everything that you say and everything that I say is taken to account in the Shemayim. And I'm so happy that I worship the Elohim of Hebrew Israel, whose name is Yahweh.
Amen.
This has been Rabbi Robert B. Holman Jr.
and Sean Appleton.
And this has been
Hebrews in Exile.
Shalom.